And we are now live on the Wandering Pilgrims. This is another one of our extra special shows, because of course every one of the shows that we do is extra special. And tonight on our extra special show, we have our special guests, John Zambrotto and Shawn Hare, both very passionately convinced of their particular views of, respectively, Evangelical Universalism and Eternal Conscious Torment. And so we didn't really agree on any rules or anything. I'm not going to interject myself into the discussion too much because obviously I have a horse in this race and I don't want to bias anything. I just want to facilitate a good, fair discussion between two brothers in Christ and see if we can come to some kind of understanding with it. And perhaps maybe we might convert someone. So who wants to start?
I would like to concede to Shawn.
Okay. I mean, I guess the best thing to do is to have like a start with understanding where the other person is coming from, and we need to always have to identify and define terms so that we know that we're talking about the same thing when we're saying certain words. You can talk to a Mormon and say salvation, and they mean something. They'll use the same word, but they'll mean something completely different.
Yeah, talking about Celestine Kingdom and all that stuff. Yeah.
Right. So as far as salvation is a good word to define. I mean, what is it that we're being saved from and to? I guess that would be my first question to you.
My answer to that would be we're saved from our sin. We're saved from ourselves. And I believe it actually says that. I believe Paul said that Christ died for our sins.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so Christ died for...
And he died for the sins of the world. And it does say that implicitly.
Okay. Do you believe that we're saved from anything?
Ourselves.
Okay. So, how about the wrath of God?
I don't believe that we're saved from the wrath of God.
Okay.
I believe that the wrath of God still plays some part even in the Christian's life. I think that you and I may have a very different idea of what wrath is and what it means and how it's implemented. I see wrath as like gravity. I don't see it as God, I'm mad at you, I'm going to do this to you. I see it as this is the way that he set things up, and this is the way things carry themselves out. That's what I think about wrath.
I guess I don't understand. What's the wrath part of whatever it is that you're saying?
What do you mean? What's the wrath part? Like, what is it?
I mean, wrath has to do with, it has to do with punishment. That's the definition of, it's God's anger. God's angry about something. That's something that Christ himself says over and over again and constantly warns us about the wrath of God. He says to the Pharisees, "Who warned you to flee from the wrath of God?" So it's like, What is Jesus talking about? That's and all the other passages where Jesus is telling people, that the wrath of God abides on you if you don't believe.
Yes. The wrath. What I'm trying to say is that it's not that God is. He's not involving himself in every person's life in a wrathful manner. He set up the rules of how things work, and wrath happens. Wrath is like if someone is overly promiscuous and ends up with AIDS, that would be the wrath of God. But it's because they were being overly promiscuous and
Promiscuous?
I'm sorry?
As opposed to being underly promiscuous? I'm not sure what you're meaning.
Well, promiscuous in general, I guess.
Okay. So it sounds to me like you're saying that wrath just has to do with consequences, and as it doesn't have to do with God actually doing anything.
I think that would be he did do it, and he is doing it because he set up that rule, but you know, he set up the way that the universe works. So, but yeah, I would agree that it is a consequence, sure.
But where are you getting that from?
What do you mean?
Where do you get the idea of what you're explaining to me from? What passages in the scripture are you getting that from?
Honestly, I don't have a particular scripture that I can call to mind at the moment. But if you want to go through some of them, I suppose we could.
Well, I mean, there wouldn't be any verses that I could come up with that would have anything to do with the description that you just gave, because the only wrath that I know of is the one that's described in the scriptures, and it has to do with fire and eternal punishment and all that kind of stuff that Jesus spoke about. And you know, I can't just make up what I think ought to be the way that it is, or philosophize about it. I have to go by a source that's above and beyond me, because we can all make up something and disagree with one another or agree with one another. But we have to have I need to have an absolute foundation that I can draw what the truth is from. You know.
Sure.
May I and if this is out of bounds, then I can defer. But in defining wrath, you mind if I just say what comes to mind when I think of the definition of wrath?
Sure.
I see throughout the Old Testament, that's the ongoing theme. That's the number one theme of the Old Testament, is wrath. And that often has been levied as an excuse for atheists to accuse Christians of worshiping two gods. You know, the God of the Old Testament is wrathful, the God of the New Testament is forgiving and loving. But us Christians, we know that Jesus talks about hell far more than the Old Testament does, because, well, the Old Testament doesn't talk about hell. It does talk about the place of the dead. It does talk about things like that. But as far as wrath goes, what we see being discussed in the Old Testament, primarily, we do see some wrath towards the nations, especially in Ezekiel. Do see some wrath towards individuals, especially those who profane his holiness, like Achan or, Uzzah. That's another great one. But primarily where we see God's wrath being expressed is to the nation of Israel, his special nation, his bride, the nation that he at one point says he will punish worse than any other nation that ever lived.
Mm-hmm.
Now, through that overarching theme, I can see nothing but a correcting punishment, a correcting wrath being spoken of there. So in Old Testament typology, the only wrath of which I'm familiar with through the Old Testament is that wrath which seeks to correct. So, and I'm not going to follow up, because like I said, I've already gone too far by interjecting that. I just wanted to throw that out there in case you
I kind of thought of of an example. An example would be when Jesus was here, when he was telling them to flee from the wrath to come, he was talking about the destruction of the temple and so on. And I would see that a father's, you know, like if my kids are misbehaving, I'm going to, you know, stop it right then and there. But the way that God works, he's long-suffering, and he gives plenty of time before the boom's going to drop. And he was speaking of AD 70 when the temple was being destroyed. That was the natural consequence of them not turning. And, you know, that would be like an example of what I would say would be wrath. A consequence. Okay. A consequence of fighting against the wooden yoke that was placed upon them, the occupation of Rome, and trying to break the wooden yoke and getting the iron yoke placed on them, which is the dispersing of kicking against the goats, dispersing of Judah, you know, and the destruction of the temple, the ruining of the nations.
So then, okay, so again, you're saying wrath as being something that's just a, as you said, a natural consequence or a law a principle that God sets in motion but doesn't actively pursue himself.
Obviously he pursues it in some way, shape, or form, but you gotta remember, like, these things are put into a human language, you know, these workings of God are put into a human language when it's very hard, and we see through a dark glass dimly, you know, we're expressing all these ideas in human terms. You know, this is the way that this omniscient, omnipotent being that we know as our Father had set things up, and this is the way it works, you know.
Yeah, well, I'm not asking about how the inner workings are, so to speak. I'm just asking whether or not God is actively pursuing wrath upon a people.
I've heard
you use a couple of different terms. You said Father and things like that. Everywhere in the Old Testament and the New Testament as well, God reveals himself as Father to his covenant people. He is nowhere referred to as the Father of the unregenerate or of unbelievers. The only passage that we have in the Scripture about God being the Father of all men is actually just a quote from a pagan poem that Paul is using to communicate an idea to the Greeks. He's not making a doctrinal statement about that, because the rest of the Scriptures would contradict that as far as being, you know, God being the Father of the spiritual father, so to speak, of all men. That gets dangerously close to Mormonism, really. God certainly is the creator of all men, but as far as God is the Father, God becomes our Father when we trust in God, when we trust in Christ. I'm not going to get into the whole...
Well, yeah, obviously, we become great engrafted into the vine. I understand that.
You got to remember, these things have a lot of present progressive verbs attached to them. Believing, John 3:16, that whosoever believing, it's not whoever believes.
Just at one time.
Yeah, no, not at one. Of course, not at one time. I'm not an easy believism. Whoever is believing, to him, you know. That's the right to be called the father, the sons and fathers. And I agree with you, Sean, very much, and I get a lot of flack from other universalists, that I very much believe that God is very active in his affairs with man, that there are natural consequences, like Johnny said. But I do, I can't help but see God spanking some behinds. So.
Oh, I definitely see that too. But what I take issue with from what you're asking me right off the bat is you go straight to wrath. And the only axiomatic statement in the New Testament ascribed to God is love. And you go straight to wrath. And I don't really understand that. I don't understand why that's your first question.
Well, because it had to do with salvation. What are we being saved from and to? That's why that came up. And the whole purpose, the whole point of hell, has to do with the wrath of God. That's, you know, that we're not talking about other things. We're talking about that which is directly connected to the wrath of God. Eric is saying is for corrective purposes, and I don't see how in the world that Eric is getting that out of the Old Testament at all. The Noahic flood was not for any kind of disciplinary purposes. It was to destroy mankind from off the face of the earth, and only 8 people survived. Millions of people died. God had no mercy on them. You know, the only mercy that the grace that he showed them was, here's this man for 500 years building this ark. He's a righteous man. You're all a bunch of God-forsaken pagans sacrificing your babies and things like that, and this man loves God, and he's doing this crazy-looking thing out in the middle of nowhere, and people are making fun of him. You got to figure there's a big sign saying, come buy tickets just to watch the crazy moron build a boat out in the middle of nowhere for no reason. People are just lining up and mocking him, and God's going, God's like, you're about to find out, here comes the story, you know? And they're all destroyed. Millions of people are destroyed. 8 people survive. Where is the corrective? Where is anything corrective in that? I see completely
because
wrath.
Because it stops them from further degenerating. It stops them from, you know, it's just like corporal punishment for a murderer is number one to avenge the death or what have you, to give peace to the family. Number two, to save society from, you know, having such a person, out there, you know, murdering. And three, it also, you know, kind of takes them out of their misery, so to speak. The person who did the murdering.
Well, while that's all fine and good, it still takes the person out of the picture. They're gone. There's no more life for them. Their life is over, and that's what God did to all these people. He wiped them out of the face of the earth. They had nothing else left. And it's not because everybody on the boat was a wonderful, good person. I mean, Noah had his, who's still a sinner. Mm-hmm. His family proves to still be sinners as well. But God chose to rescue them because of the one man, Noah, whom he chose out of his own goodness. He didn't choose to save everybody else.
We are overlapping categories here. There is the individual sense of salvation. There's the corporate sense of salvation.
Yeah.
So I think there's a bit of an overlap that's going on there, and maybe like one of you guys could pick one and focus on that first, and then go to the other one.
I just don't see what the difference is, because God is going to send groups to hell, because God's absolutely sovereign, and according to the scriptures, He has determined where, when, and under what conditions every single person is going to be born, live, and die. I mean, you know that from passages such as in the Psalms, and He's determined the boundaries of every man. It determined what everywhere he's going to live and die and walk and all that sort of thing. It doesn't mean he's puppetizing everybody. It simply means that God has sovereignly decreed where, when, and under what conditions everybody's going to be born. I was born now. I could not have been born then or in the future, because God ordained that I was born in 1963, in Greenville, South Carolina. You know, when it snowed, it had to be those exact conditions. That was when I was ordained to be born. While Jesus was walking the earth 2,000 years ago, there were people living over here in the Americas. There were people down in the far reaches of Africa and South America and way over out east who would live and die and never once hear the gospel. And that is what God determined to do. Okay? So I'm not trying to get into a big thing about the sovereignty of God.
Well, let's talk about that. It's all connected. Let's talk about that, though. Let's talk about those that never heard the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
I don't believe that somebody not hearing the gospel, when they die, that they just go straight to hell because they never heard the gospel. I believe that...
Why not?
Huh?
Why not? Why shouldn't they go to hell?
Well, it's given unto man once to die, and after that, the judgment.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe at the judgment, that's when they see, you know, who God is, and they see Christ, and... just as Christ preached to the spirits in prison between the time of his death and resurrection, I believe that people will, as the same, hear and be given a choice, and that's what I think.
The whole thing about choice becomes a problem too, because man is in a fallen state, okay? We're all fallen in Adam. Adam fell, and we're born, everybody who's born after him is in a fallen estate. Nobody's going to naturally go towards Christ. Jesus says that only those whom the Father draws to him are those who come to him. And he says, all whom the Father has given me will come to me, and I will raise them up on the last day. Everyone who learns from the Father comes to me, and I'll raise them up on the last day.
Yeah, it does say that. And it also says, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto myself.
Okay.
And it's been pointed out by many people who have looked into the Greek of that word draw. Literally, it means drag.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
All men.
Here's the problem with all men. The word all men, a whole world is always going to be determined by its context, and almost always in the immediate context it's going to tell you what it means. Otherwise it turns into an absurdity, and can bring up a few of those here about just a few of those. You can see in Mark 1:5, and there went out unto him all the land of Judea and they of Jerusalem, and were all baptized of him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Every single last person did? No, they didn't. And as the people were this is Luke 3:15, as the people were in expectation, and all men mused in their hearts of John whether he were of Christ or not. No, not every single individual did that, and not every single individual anywhere else. But it's even giving you the context there anyway. It says, as they came to John, he said to them, Rabbi, he that was with you beyond the Jordan, to whom have you bear witness? Behold, the same baptizes, and all come to him. But all didn't come to him, because you had people were standing aside going, I'm not doing that. You know, it's all of whom. It is always all, but all of whom are we talking about?
Well, I can answer that for you. I mean, unless you want to continue, I could...
I've got massive lists of all and world and all that kind of stuff that prove that just because you have the word all there doesn't mean everybody...
I don't really think that proves it. I mean, these are different situations and different books and different letters.
Well, you mentioned a specific passage, Johnny.
Which one?
I'll draw all men... John 12?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So God, Christ is going to draw every single individual to him and to himself.
Well, here, let's qualify that. If you look at 1 Corinthians 15, 22, it's a very equivocation here, a strong equivocation. For as in Adam, all die. Mm-hmm. Now, you would say in Adam, there every single person that ever lived is Adam, correct?
Is in Adam, correct.
So, for as in Adam, all die. So, as in. So that means this is an equivocation being made here. So also, in Christ, will all be made alive. Everybody is in Adam. And not only that, Jesus is the second Adam.
Yeah, the second Adam of a new creation. Correct.
What do you do with that? He is the second Adam.
Right, he's the second Adam of a new creation.
Of a new creation, it doesn't say that.
The
first Adam failed, the second Adam was victorious.
What do you mean it doesn't say that? It says all things are new. And I'll find the passage for you. Absolutely says that this is a new creation. And that's the whole purpose of all this stuff. It's a new creation. Christ is the new Adam, it's a new creation.
The first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam, a life-giving spirit.
Right. To everyone whom the Father has given him. You can't forget that those verses are there.
It doesn't say that.
Yeah, it does say that. Jesus said, all whom the Father has given me.
Not where I'm reading.
Well, no, it doesn't say it there.
Romans 15. So is written, the first man, Adam, became a living soul. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. That's all it says.
Okay, that's all it says.
The spiritual is not first, but the natural, then the spiritual. The first man is from the earth, earthly. The second man is from heaven.
Right. So does that verse live by itself?
No, it doesn't. But when you take a look at, like Romans 5, I'll match it up with Romans 5:18. Consequently, just as one trespass resulted in the condemnation for how many people? Oh, just the peoples. Just the condemnation for the Scythians. For all people. So just as one trespass resulted in condemnation for all people, I know you're going to agree that all people were condemned, so also one righteous act resulted in justification in life for some people, a few people, eight people on the ark. No, all people.
Okay.
Just as through the disobedience of the one man, the many, were made sinners, so also through the obedience of the one man, the second Adam, the many will be made righteous. It's the many, the many. It's not all Adam is screwed, but you know, just a few people are going to be saved out of it. It's all.
So let me just say, it sounds like you're saying that this passage to you, Johnny, is talking about one group of people with a one-to-one correspondence, and Shawn, what it seems to me is that you're saying the second group is a subset of the first.
I haven't said anything at all. Okay. I'm saying, well, it is a subset of the group, and because it has to be, because the rest of the scriptures doesn't allow it to be that. And that's why I said that verse is not an island. It has to, that verse has to work with every other verse in the Bible. And Jesus said that only those whom the Father has given him will come to him. And Jesus says, only my sheep hear my voice and follow me. And he says to them people very specifically, you are not my sheep. He says, you do not believe because you are not my sheep.
He doesn't say
you're not my sheep because you don't believe. He says, you don't believe because you're not my sheep.
So are we going to pit Jesus against Paul?
Of course not. That's okay. The point. We don't pit them against each other. They have to work together.
So then qualify that.
Qualify what?
Well, you're saying that all that you gave to me came to me, and he who came to me I will not cast out. You're mm-hmm. saying there that that doesn't include everybody, but Paul obviously in two places that I just mentioned includes everybody.
No, it doesn't. Paul is saying is in perfect keeping with what Jesus said before he said that. And he knew that Jesus said that before he said that. But you can't go and it's like if you were to write a letter to your mother, somebody would have to know something about the relationship that you have with your mother. Or, you know, if that letter that you write doesn't exist by itself floating out in the middle of an ether somewhere, the thing that Paul is saying has to do directly with what Jesus has already said, and Jesus is speaking through him authoritatively anyway when he says that. So it can't be. There's no pitting against anything. That's the whole point. It can't be pitted against him. Both of those have to work together. So the all in that has to be qualified by what Jesus says about who it is that's going to come to him. And it's only those whom the Father has given him from the foundation of the world, those whose names are written in the book of life. Why have a book of life if everybody's already written in it?
Okay. Well, if that's the case, I'm glad that, because I actually had this in my notes, but I'm glad that Eric posted this. In Isaiah 45, it says, I have sworn by myself. And this
hey, is I just want to say real quick, Shawn, no one else but us can see those things in the chat. That's for our private communication. That's why I'm typing that stuff in there for things that I don't feel comfortable mentioning on the show, just for anyone to use, okay?
Can you see the chat, Shawn?
Huh?
You see the chat?
I didn't see it that time. I saw one previous, but I was looking
at the top left. There's a little blue chat bubble.
Okay.
And you can click that, and it'll open up the chat. If you want to type any notes or anything like that, you can do that.
Oh, I got you. Okay.
Anyway, Isaiah 45:23. I have sworn by myself, the word has gone forth from my mouth in righteousness and will not turn back, that to me every knee will bow, mm-hmm. and every tongue will swear allegiance. Allegiance.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean to you? What does every tongue swearing allegiance mean to you?
They're ruled by God.
I mean, maybe, but as far as I'm concerned, an ally is somebody who is on the side of.
Well, Melinda just.
You know, like I mean, if if we're at war with Japan and they say, well, we're going to make an allegiance. That's going to mean that we're working together, the two nations, where we agree with each other, okay? And it says, every tongue will swear allegiance, and that's what Paul and some of the other writers are quoting, when they mention that in the New Testament. They will say of me, only in the Lord. This is the people that are bowing and swearing allegiance to God. He says, they will say to me, only in the Lord are righteousness and strength. Men will come to him, and all who were angry at him will be put to shame.
Put to shame.
Yeah, because they were unaligned with him before, and now they are aligned with him. There is an allegiance being made. They're put to shame because they saw him as evil. They saw him as not worthy of their worship. They saw him not worthy of their love, and they were put to shame because they were angry at him, and they realized what a wonderful love.
That's an awful lot of reading into the passage there.
Not at all. It says, men come to him and we're angry at him and we'll be put to shame. So what is it going to do?
I don't see anything about them being angry with him and put
to
shame.
It says right here, verse 24, they will say of me, only in the Lord are righteousness and strength.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Men will come to him. And all who were angry at him will be put to shame.
Oh, incense, okay. Yeah, so they will be put to shame.
Okay, and does that mean toasted in a volcano for all of eternity?
Yes, it does. Does it mean,
no, it doesn't. It doesn't.
Yeah, yes, it does. It absolutely does. Look.
No, I can prove it.
I can relate to a time when I was a teenager and I got in a fight with this guy, a physical fight, fist fight. And down south, you kind of get into a fight with people just because you're bored and don't have anything else to do. So we got into a fight with this guy, and this other guy that was more friendly to me or whatever than the other guys, he was talking as if I won the fight, and I did. The guy kicked my butt, okay? And it's like, absolutely not. The guy kicked my butt. I'm able to dislike the guy and still reverence the fact that the guy defeated me.
That's a lot more reading into that than I was doing.
I'm not reading into anything. That's simply my experience, and simply saying that I can understand how somebody can be able to look at somebody and say, absolutely, that guy's right. And I hate his guts.
They're going to say he's righteous when they're toiling around in the lake of fire. They're going to say, oh, he's so righteous. I'm in here in horrible pain, going underneath the volcano, and they're going to. Come on, man. I mean, that's ridiculous.
Number one, you're making this out to be something that it's not. Okay, this is not a complete description of how everything is going to turn out. This is talking about God's righteousness.
Every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father.
That's right.
It brings him glory to reconcile because that's his plan.
It also brings glory to him.
Look at Acts 3:20.
And his righteousness.
If you look at Acts 3:20, it says, and that he may send Jesus, the Christ appointed for you, whom heaven must receive until the period of restoration of all things. Other verses say reconciliation of all things. And others, even more interestingly, in the King James, it says the restitution of all things.
It's a Greek word, apokatastasis.
Yes. And I think the King James rendering of it is quite interesting. Because it's restitution, it's something that's paid back, it's something that, you know what I'm saying? It's something that was bad and got fixed.
Okay, you're using some different words there, and I'm trying to figure out exactly who's doing what here. So, restitution? Who's paying restitution?
Well, Jesus said that they will pay back to the last farthing.
Well, yeah, in a completely different passage. What are you talking about?
Well, we're talking about after death, those that are not sealed in Christ will go to judgment, and they will be assigned a judgment to restore them to where they can make restitution for the things that they've done. You know, it's like yes.
Where does it say that?
It says it in, if every man shall be salted by fire. It says that.
Where are you getting this stuff from? Where are you getting it from?
Every man shall be salted by fire. That's in the Bible. Have you ever seen that verse?
Well, I don't know. You have to give me which translation you're talking about.
I'm thinking that's 1 Corinthians.
I'll tell you right now. Actually, Jesus said it. In Mark 5, everyone will be salted with fire. That's what Jesus said.
What's the passage? I'd have to look it up because I don't even know what
Mark 9:49.
Mark 9:49?
Correct.
Okay.
And that jives completely with the picture that's painted in 1 Corinthians about being tested by fire. So I don't think anyone's debating that there is an element of the all-consuming fire that each believer has to face post-mortem.
So Paul
built... Sean, did you have an objection to that?
Well, I got to see the context that's even going on here. Well, Mark 9?
9:49, yeah.
Here, let me just look it up real quick, and I will quote it to you. Mark
9:49. Okay.
Or if you have it, you can go ahead. I mean,
yeah. Whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it will be better for him to be better for him if a great millstone were hung around his neck and he were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life crippled than with two hands to go into hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame than with 2 feet to be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to sin, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than with 2 eyes to be thrown into hell, where the worm dies not and the fire is not quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Everyone in hell will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if the salt has lost its saltiness, how will you make it salty again?
Hold on.
Have salt in yourself and have peace with one another. And fire simply in this life would be simply trials by fire, so to speak. But as far as...
Well, hold on now.
Everybody's going to hell.
It says everyone will be salted by fire. It doesn't say everyone who is in hell will be salted by fire. It says everyone will be salted by fire. You added to that. After you said everyone will be salted by fire, you then said everyone in hell will be salted by fire, which was a reading into the text. But let's talk about that passage.
Everyone has to have a context.
Hold on. Yeah, it does need a context. What is he talking
about? I will draw all men to myself. No, he doesn't.
That word hell is Gehenna.
Yeah.
Do you know what Gehenna is?
It's a big trash pile.
Yes, it's from the Valley of Hinnom. Okay? Yeah. That's where the Israelites really ticked God off when they were throwing their children into fire. And in Jeremiah had said to them, it hasn't even entered into my mind to burn somebody like that, to do something like that to a child. Mm-hmm. That's what Jeremiah said.
Yes, like, I know that.
Because God's not a torturer. Okay, is a torturer.
That's not what he means by that. He means he never told them to burn their babies.
I realize that.
Right.
And the reason why is because he wouldn't have anybody to do that. He is a righteous and loving God.
He wouldn't have any of us to do that.
He would. Right. So you're telling me he's the type of God that is do as I say and not as I do?
Well, of course he is. He's holy and righteous.
No, of course not. I will take a huge, huge problem with that. Because,
well, of course you will, because you're thinking out of your flesh.
You're thinking out of your flesh, thinking that God would do all these things which we would deem to be, you know, unrighteous. And
well, God killed millions of people in a flood.
Yeah, and they needed to be killed because things were getting worse and worse.
Oh, even the babies?
Yes, because the babies. Because we could talk about morphic resonance.
Yeah, Sean, I think I'm pretty sure you're the Linus Seth kind of guy, and I have no problem with it, because I'll just say that they were angel half-breeds, and they were abominations. But that's what it means when it says that Noah was perfect.
But Noah's family?
Noah was perfect in his generations. That is a particular Hebrew construct that has a very odd connotation to it that can't be encapsulated by the Linus Seth theory.
Okay, and so it's just because they were genetic freaks then.
It's not merely a matter of genetic freaks. They were evil. They were destroying everything.
They were half angel or whatever.
Yeah.
So I mean, that's the only. I just bring that up because I know that that's something that we're just going to have to agree to disagree on. My interpretation is the vast majority interpretation. The Reformed interpretation does depart from that, as do many others nowadays. And the Linus Seth interpretation has gained popularity. Historically speaking, well, it is what it is.
I'd like to continue talking about Gehenna for a moment, because. What would happen to somebody who their eyes cause them to stumble or their hand cause them to stumble, what would be the natural progression of them is, you know, in some cases, dying in dishonorable death. And people who died a dishonorable death back then would not be given a grave. They would be stoned outside of the camp, and their bodies would be thrown into Gehenna. And that's what Jesus is talking about there. He's not talking about, the context is not talking about after you die being thrown into hell. That's how the translators translated it. But there's four different words. There's four different words that are all translated hell. You have Hades, Sheol, Tartarus, and Gehenna. And all four words are rendered hell in a lot of these older versions. And
so Jesus is only talking to the Jews in the immediate context. He's not talking to anybody else then, is what you're saying.
Yeah, he is. He's saying if your eye causes you to stumble, pluck it out, because it's better for you to enter into life missing an eye than for you to be thrown into Gehenna, your whole body thrown into Gehenna. And to them, think about if he was saying that to us. He's saying it's better for you to Hold on, let me finish my statement.
The problem is you keep jumping between him talking to a group of people and then talking about eternal life. Which one is it? It's either eternal life and eternal damnation, or temporal life and temporal damnation. It's not throwing in two different things. Who gives a crap? I don't give a crap if somebody throws me on a pile of burning feces and garbage. Because no, they wouldn't. Not if they knew that they had eternal life with Christ.
They sure would, because you got to put your mind. Hold on a second. You got to put yourself into the mind frame of an early Jew from that time, from who was Jesus was talking about.
It's just like you were saying
the other night. You were saying, well, I can't condemn Calvin because I'm a modern person and I don't understand the way that things worked back when Calvin was there. And I'm saying that you're looking at it from a modern point of view, and that's not at all how a Jew would look at what Jesus was saying.
It's totally, it's two different things. Jesus is using an illustration that they understand. The Gehenna garbage pile, they understand that. And whatever other kind of cultural connections that there are to it is fine, whatever. The problem is he's talking about entering eternal life. Eternal life cannot be contrasted with thrown onto an existing garbage pile.
So what was the Jewish concept of the afterlife at the time in which Jesus spoke? How did they have a doctrine of heaven and hell?
I have no idea, because Jesus is the main one who pretty much talked about it. He's pretty much the as far as I understand, he's the one who revealed those sorts of things. It's just like there was no real doctrine of the Trinity, so to speak, until Jesus came along and started blatantly saying that he's God.
Yeah, but if
he started revealing the Holy Spirit.
If we look at it from how you're saying it, it's basically you're basically saying that, and I'm not judging God here. I'm judging what you're saying, okay? But the way that you're putting it is that they really had, you know, the Jews back then, they really had no warning. They didn't know, you know, how awful it could be for them if they died the death. You know, they didn't realize that after they died, well, man, you're gonna be thrown into a pressure cooker for all of eternity. They had no idea, and how is that fair to them? And then you're saying Jesus came along and said, oh, well, you think you're just going to go into the grave, but what's really going to happen is if you're not a good boy, you're going to be thrown into a volcano forever and ever without any chance of coming out, any chance of redemption, and it's simply false.
It's exactly right. There is no chance. There is no chance involved here. And this is the problem. You see, universalism is merely the logical conclusion of Arminianism. Because Pelagianism.
It's not.
Are you serious?
Logical conclusion of Arminianism and Pelagianism because it
Wait, Sean.
Let me finish what I'm saying, for crying out loud. If you're gonna ask,
go ahead.
Let me finish it. because it basically says that man has the ability to turn himself from his sins in repentance and faith towards Christ.
That's exactly the straw manity of it. The straw manity of it. That is not what it says at all.
Prove me wrong.
Okay, I'm breaking etiquette here. But because you mischaracterize the universalist position, that's the only reason why.
No, it's not your position. I'm not saying that's what you believe. I'm saying that that's what it is. It is the absolute.
It's not true, though. There's many Calvinists that come. Look at. Do you know who Robert Rubio is? Rubio was a high Calvinist, and he came.
Whatever. That totally does not impress me at all.
He's still a Calvinist. He's still a Calvinist and believes in ultimate reconciliation.
No, he isn't. Plain and simple, no, he isn't.
Well, there's no such thing as Calvinism really these days, because Calvin doesn't agree with Calvinism. But I will say that it is far easier to come to Universalism from Calvinism if you are a compatibilist, which you are. You are a compatibilist.
Absolutely.
Define that term, because I'm not up with a lot of these terms.
Compatibilism is merely the idea that God's sovereign will and his painting the picture from eternity doesn't do violence to free will choices being involved in the painting of that picture. Just because he established and foreordains it doesn't mean that part of the means used is free will choices. And it's not Molinism, in which he just predicts it. He does ordain it, but there comes a point where you have to realize that there's a certain level of mystery, because nobody even understands their own will. And anyone who thinks they do is lying to themselves. We don't know why we do everything we do, but we do know that we feel it and we do want to be free. There's a level of freedom that every Calvinist admits. I admitted a little bit less freedom than most in being a high Calvinist. And in Universalism, I would say that the freedom that we have is more in how we receive what is given to us, not so much in whether we are able to receive it. So, like, you know many people who come to Christ that are super enthusiastic, and then others are kind of lackluster. There's wiggle room within the sphere of God's will that gives us that motility to actually make our own destiny to a degree within that sphere. But to say that Universalism is a product of some form of semi-Pelagianism is to miss the fact that the whole purpose of hell in the evangelical universalist is for correction. That is a unilateral action of God, that without that action, that person would never come to repentance. That's what hell is to the universalist, or to the purgatorial universalist. I got to clarify there, is that hell is the last ditch, the last solution, the final solution. It's like, look, you know, Jesus is like, did everything else. You are without excuse. Here's the cold, hard fact of it, or rather the burning hot fact of it. This is who I am. You will accept it, period.
So, again, you're saying that fire and pain and whatever, or for whatever determined amount of time, who the heck knows, is sufficient to turn somebody from their
I don't admit the category of time. I don't admit the category of time postmortem. I do not admit the category of time postmortem.
Forget the time then. Let's just say whatever that somebody's in hell, that the punishment in hell is sufficient enough to turn somebody from unbelief
that's obvious. Have you ever touched a hot pipe? Did you touch a hot pipe twice?
Well, hold on a second, Johnny. You're not seeing where he's coming from. He's talking about total inability. You got to understand that dead men don't walk, and that's what I'm trying to say. Is that there is every person in their category serves the purposes of God in his own self-revelation. And when it comes to the valley of the dry bones, every man in their own season, there are some who come sooner than others, some who are at their very last breath. The experience of hell is the experience of those who have not come to Christ. And whatever experience the process of adding unto whatever the privation has subtracted from them, I can't say. I don't claim exhaustive knowledge. And I'm not even saying that, again, like I prefaced this before the show, I don't know that I necessarily believe that this is 100% true. It just seems to be the best way to make sense of Scripture for me, okay? Because there's the vast majority of Universalists disagree with me in this matter.
vast majority of them disagree with the God who's going to sit there and blister their son's ass. I have no problem with corporal punishment. I'm a father myself, so I get it. There is a bridge between, I don't even want to call it that, but there's a bridge between prevenient grace and a completely monolithic grace from God. I'm not saying that everyone has the ability, but everyone has the knowledge, and Romans bears that out very much when it says that all without excuse. And that knowledge, that ability, for some can only be given when they're actually confronted with the unmitigated person of Christ himself, free from all the veils that this life affords.
All right. Jesus asked, who do you say that I am? And Peter said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, and which means he's God in the flesh. You know, we all know that, right? That's what he was talking about. Didn't mean some bizarre Aryan notion or whatever. He's basically saying, you're God. We know you're God because, and Jesus said, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven revealed it to you. The revealing of the Father, of the Son, and the revealing of the Son by the Father are things that must happen in order for someone to turn from their sins, turn from the love of their sins. Everybody, unregenerate person, loves their sins, and they have to be turned from that to faith in Christ and repentance. This is an act of God. Our faith is a gift from God. Mm-hmm. And if God gave Peter that gift and the other disciples along with him in whatever time that they finally grasped what was really going on, Jesus has to reveal, and he says that he reveals the Father to whomever he wills. Do both of you recognize that verse, or do I need to look it up?
I'm pretty sure we both
recognize it.
Okay. Jesus says that he reveals the Father to whomever he wills. Well, quite obviously, he doesn't reveal the Father to everybody, because not everybody comes to repentance and faith in this life, right? So let's just say that universalism is true. And so you got Jesus revealing the Father in this life to some people, and they come to repentance and faith in this life. Other people don't, and he doesn't reveal the Father to them. They go to hell, and then he reveals to them the Father in hell. Okay, are you saying that is a possibility?
No, I don't think so. Rephrase, well, no, don't rephrase. Just repeat the last 10 seconds of what you just said, just so make sure I got it right.
Okay, in order for somebody to come to faith in Christ, the Father has to be revealed to them, right?
Okay, yes, that. There's stuff that came before that. Where was I going in my thoughts? There is a dual revelation. There's special and general revelation. And
right.
we are just as accountable for the general revelation as we are for the special.
Right. But the general revelation doesn't bring faith and repentance.
It doesn't. We have to come to grips with some capacity that it makes not only that person without excuse, but their end fate just.
Right, right, exactly. So their punishment is just if God was to punish them, correct?
Yeah, and from the Calvinistic standpoint, that's pretty easy because everyone deserves punishment from the standpoint. It's only those who receive that mercy that get the buy from it. They don't deserve it. It's not like everyone's entitled to it.
Right. So, but that's general revelation. But as far as the special revelation, which is the Son revealing the Father to them, that is what's necessary by the Spirit, with the working of the Holy Spirit in that person, bringing that person to repentance and faith is something that's necessary for them. They can't just decide, you know what, today I just feel like being a Christian. Nobody's going to do that, right?
No,
I don't think that.
They're going to stand before God and see him for who he is. And be put to shame and begin the process of, you know, restitution, reconciliation.
I think what we're missing from this is John.
The Bible never says that the deal is sealed once you die.
I think what we're missing from this, John, is you're giving way too much credit to means in a particular moment, whereas Sean, you're not giving much credit for means at all. The Ordo Salutis has a lot to do with a lot of secondary means. It's on some level, the Spirit of God is indwelling the believer. What form that takes, the process of that, that's been so debated, even amidst very Calvinists themselves, everyone doesn't know what's really going on there. You know, total sanctification and all that stuff. So what I'm saying is that there is, everyone has a season, everyone has a purpose to fulfill in this life. Post-mortem, like I said, I don't admit time as a category just because I don't think it's there. But I don't think that you can say it's an instant. I think for me to try to characterize anything at that point would be very presumptuous of me. What I can see is that what was not done in this life is brought to completion through some process that's described as both a testing that's likened to a refiner's fire, and that it also brings about the final end product of that ultimate correction.
It's still not really getting at the heart of what I'm getting at.
Okay.
Okay. I don't have a problem with much of what you're saying there, and I've wondered about the what is the time thing or whatever anywhere, you know, as far as after the afterlife. But
well, I know you used to be a lot more universalist friendly. 3-4 years ago, you toyed around with the ideas a little bit.
No.
I had a few conversations. You said you ultimately came down on the side that you were against it, that you didn't see it in Scripture, but that you thought that there's a slight possibility that you could be wrong and that you hope that maybe you could be.
No, I as far as I'm concerned, if God wants to do that, that's fine with me.
I might have misunderstood God.
It's not found in the Scriptures.
And I want to clarify that I feel the same way. If God is indeed, the way that you say he is, I don't take a problem with that. I just take a problem with the interpretation. I know ultimately that God is good, and God is going to do the righteous thing, and in the end, I am going to be okay with whatever decisions he makes and whatever judgments he makes. Mm-hmm. I'm not one of those people that are like, oh, I couldn't worship a God that would do that, blah, blah, blah. I'm not that way. You know, I come from a not Reformed background, but I come from a Baptist background, and that's, you know, how I was, you know, I was raised, you know, all, you know, eternal conscious torment, and when I started doing my own study, that's when, you know, things like this started becoming clear to me. But I just want to make the point that I, you know, if that's what God wants to do, I don't believe that Scripture shows that. That he's going to do that way, but if I'm wrong, which is a good is a possibility that I'm wrong, just as I could be wrong about everything that I believe or everything that I know, but I'm gonna be I'm gonna still smile at God for how he does things because I know he's gonna do the right thing.
Right, that's a good attitude. So I still would like to get an answer to my question though, which is that. Again, if indeed our faith, and according to the Scriptures it is, our faith is a gift from God, and that Christ must reveal the Father to us in this life in order for us to come to repentance and faith. Because, I mean, James says, concerning faith, he says, show me your faith. Your faith isn't just believing in facts. He says the devils believe and tremble. He says, but that doesn't mean that they're saved. So my question is, if it's necessary for Christ to reveal the Father to someone in order for them to come to repentance and faith, okay, why is it that he allows people to go to hell or purgatory first in order for Jesus to suddenly pop in and say, hey, now I'm going to reveal the Father to you?
For the same reason he damns people to hell eternally in your theology, because it glorifies him to do it that way. We don't know how, but it does.
I don't see that in the Scriptures anywhere.
I'm glad that you said that. I'm glad because I thought for a second you were going to make a philosophical argument. So
no,
I'm glad.
My question is, what are they suffering in hell for?
I don't think that a present progressive verb can be applied to that. I think
they're suffering for their sins.
I think they suffer the fires of hell, which purges them of their sins. And that smoke rises forever and ever in the presence of the saints as a memorial to the old man who's been put to death.
Well, something can't smoke if it doesn't have something to burn.
Sure it can, if it doesn't have anywhere to go.
Well, actually, there's a very interesting thing that I learned about the smoke of their torment.
It's actually a picture of incense. That's the Old Testament typology. It's a prayer to God.
Well, there's the word, I think it's bazinos or something like that. I'm not exactly sure how to pronounce the word. But it can be translated touchstone. And are you guys familiar with what a touchstone is?
Yeah, you're taking a page from...
I'm a jeweler. This is what I do for a profession. Mm-hmm. And when I'm testing gold, I use a little bit of acid on a touchstone, and it burns away the impurities. And when it burns away the impurities, smoke comes off of the touchstone.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that, you know, the lake of fire or what have you, the smoke of their torment rising up forever and ever is a testing. It's a... it's just like Paul said, and I think it's 1 Corinthians 15, testing gold and silver and so on, and that hay and stubble would be burned up. I believe that connects with each other.
And I think that hay and stubble is burning forever, that it keeps burning.
Sure. Hold up, Johnny.
What?
But works aren't floating out in some nebulous nowhere. That they're connected to the person.
Well, these are all allegories that we're using. These are all metaphors.
Well exactly. But the thing is that the smoke of their torment is what it says. Mm-hmm. The smoke of their torment ascends upward forever.
And I could talk about
reconciliation. It's of their torment.
And I could talk about that Miley Cyrus breakup that I had a few years ago that haunts me to this day. It sounds like the same thing. You know what? Those are the tears that God wipes from their eyes. I don't know. I'm not. It just. I understand what you're saying, and I understand that. Yes, if what you're saying is true, it fits your side. I am also saying that it can fit my side just as neatly, and that it's not definitive to either way.
With this torment, the word is bassanos. And bassanos.
Is that where we get bassoon from?
I don't know. Maybe.
I betcha.
Yeah, there's an interesting article here that I could send to you, Sean, that talks about that.
Hey, by the way, I really hope you don't feel like we're ganging up on you, dude. I didn't mean to do to be like I said. I just wanted to kind of referee, but you know. It's like, I know where you're coming from, and I can tell that Johnny's not quite hearing what you're saying sometimes.
Cause that's fine. As long as Johnny's okay with it, I'm okay with it. It's fine.
Oh, yeah. I was going to, actually, Sean, I figured since we've been talking for an hour, I was going to, have a few people come in, and, you know, we could have questions and answers and, you know, talk about that stuff if it's cool with you.
Oh, it's kind of, well, I guess you could if you want to. I don't know that we've really gotten much of anywhere here on, but, yeah.
Okay. Well, we could just continue on also, but I would like just a two-minute break. I'll be right back, okay?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, go ahead. Sean, what I was going to say to you is, I do that weekly Universalist show with Jason. I mean, you and I could get together weekly and do something like this where we focus on one particular part of Scripture, you know, because you can't, the reason why Jason and I stretched it out to a long series that's probably going to end up, I mean, it's already over 70 hours, probably going to end up being more than that, because it's when you establish a theology, you've got to really, cover a lot of different bases and come from different angles, and I think that Calvin did a really good job of that. I think that Luther probably did a bit of a better job, but he's a little... What's that?
With the table talks that he had.
Well, Luther was just more comprehensive. You know, Calvin always wanted a final answer, whereas Luther was okay with the mystery. And I think that's something where Lutherans kind of have... It infuriates me, by the way. I have a hard time talking to Lutherans sometimes because of how they just default to the, oh, well, it's just a mystery. It's just a mystery. And it's like, come on, there has to be some way it makes sense somewhere along the line.
Right.
But at the same time, there does come a point where it's like, okay, I can see how these things don't have to be mutually exclusive, but I don't know exactly how it is. So
I
let God be God.
Yeah, but, even with the as far as like the Lutheran, as far as the Lord's Supper, I find myself more very as far as real true Calvinist on that sort of thing. Whereas, except for the fact that I don't try to explain it at all. Whereas the Lutheran tries to explain it, and the Calvinist tries to explain it, and I'm like, I have no idea. It's the body of Christ, and you know, I'm not saying that it actually, because obviously, if you take the bread and the wine and you put it under a microscope, it's not going to be human flesh and human blood. But Jesus said, it's my blood and it's my body. Therefore, it is His blood and His body. And I don't know how it is, but it is. You know,
I think a lot of the confessions and creeds evolved from addressing blatant and outright heresy, right. And I wish that we would have retained that attitude rather than thinking that we can whittle away at the faith so much that we can clearly define it in such a way as to eliminate so many avenues of debate and divergence. I mean, even Paul said the word he used that's translated in the King's English heresies is just divergence or offshoots, things like that. I mean, discussions like this are really good because if you're right, the only ones who have anything to fear from exposure are the ones who are opposing you. Any exposure is good exposure. And so it's like, I'm a believer in the truth, and I believe that the more we talk about things, the more that the truth will not only show its superiority, but it will ineffably emerge to the point where you can't deny it. So, if you're game for it, I mean, we can talk about it later, but I would love to, like, make it a weekly or maybe a bi-weekly thing to, you know, just go through stuff like that.
We can always look into that.
We can call it Iron Sharpens Iron.
I think someone took that title.
who took it?
It's a Reformed ministry. Oh. I can't remember who.
Yeah, but it's Bible, so we could use it.
It's Bible, yeah. It's not copyrighted. So who was it you were wanting to invite on?
Oh, just a couple friends.
I doubt you get Tim Hall on.
No, Tim is not looking to hop on.
I keep trying to get Sims.
My friend Paul Catterett. Mm-hmm. I wanted to give him a link to get on.
I keep trying to get Sims.
He is from the Calvinist background, so mm-hmm. I thought it'd be interesting, you know, ask you a few questions or whatever, and you know.
What might be good is if we kind of broke this up into different things, because to be honest, when I first saw that first video, it's 3 hours long. I'm like, I'm never gonna do that. I did trudge through the whole thing, but it's like, that is just way too. Even an hour, we got to remember we're dealing with short attention span theater world out there. People want to see things in like 5, 10, 15 minutes max. You know what I mean? As much as I like listening to, you know, R.C. Sproul or something like that, if I see it's like 20 minutes, I'm like, oh man, you know.
So this is
watch it. You know?
This is the overarching strategy. We started out not really even caring who watched. We wanted to do it just for ourselves. We wanted to have an online discussion and record it for posterity so we could show it to friends, share it in groups and stuff like that. And more people showed interest than we thought would. And it kind of caught on, and we got some semi-famous authors to come on and have some discussions with us, and we got more technical in some ways. So we kind of, I mean, I've been kind of casting my vision and hoping people come along with me, but it's not been just me. Johnny's been pivotal in it, Justin's been pivotal in it, and others participating and whatnot. But right now, I think I hear what you're saying, and we're moving more towards the direction of greater brevity in certain areas. But
I mean, yeah, I'm speaking from somebody who's in the media business. Is what I do for a living, and brevity is extremely important.
I've said that several times. I agree with you.
The goal that Justin and I came up with was post-editing, post-processing editing.
Yeah,
that's
a lot of work ahead of you, then. Yeah,
and that's shown itself to be unrealistic. So, for right now, that's why I said the weekly thing. This is a good introduction. I mean, if we go a couple of hours, that's fine. Most people won't come into it. But if we, just to do a half hour thing talking about one passage of scripture or one topic,
right?
You know, I think that could be very viable.
Yeah, yeah. So we could pick one aspect of this particular doctrine, or like you said, one particular passage or a group of similar passages and things like that. That could be a way to go.
Yeah, I mean, if you and I are going to talk, Sean, you know, you don't have to prove Calvinism over Arminianism. I'm more Calvinist than I am Arminius. As far as, like, you know, the free will thing goes, I think even like Sam Harris, the atheist, he wrote a whole book on free will being not a true thing, you know, not just a fable that people, you know, from an atheistic standpoint, you know, people still don't have free will. They're just kind of products of their environment and products of their upbringing, products of the community of voices in their heads, and so on and so forth. So, right. You know.
I definitely believe that we are all products of those things. We can't just decide to like that which our gut despises, you know. Though we can begin to be exposed to something like that and then begin to change our minds about it. That's, we can be conditioned in that direction. But whenever I hear people say, you know, that we have no free will, that would be actually anti-Calvinistic, because, you know, we always choose in accordance with the desire of our hearts, and you know, according to the scriptures, according to the Reformed view, our hearts always choose wickedness unless, you know, we are guided by the Spirit of God, and you know, and it's more or less it's more or less a difference between bad good works and good bad works and bad bad works. You know, that's the only things that we can ever do. We can do good works, but they're never perfectly good because we're still bad. Or we can do bad works, you know, or the evil can do, you know, an unregenerate person can do a good work, but it's still bad, not accepted by God because they're evil and it's not done in faith. And of course, the evil person can do a bad, bad work, you know. But anyway.
So the most common and most orthodox definition of sin in Christendom is the doctrine of privatio boni. Which is a vastly misunderstood doctrine. It to me is something that I derived more than a decade ago myself, before I was even a Calvinist, because I couldn't conceive of sin being a thing if God created all things. So the only answer to me is that,
right?
Yeah, sin must be the lack of something. Evil must be the lack of something, and I can't. I guess maybe me being a substance monist idealist biases me. I don't know how any real thinking person can be anything but that if they really think about that. I know Nachmanides was, and he's a pretty smart dude. But to me, I just can't conceive of any way, like... Damn it, I hate it when I lose those trains of thought. It happens more often than not. I'm hearing the frigging kids play a video game out there. What's that?
The older you get, it gets worse.
Oh, privatio boni. Okay, so I cannot conceive of any way that this can work out in being a substance, that sin is a thing. So what I see is, and recently I finally put a term to it. It's a wrong order of priorities. It's a wrong order of being. That's what that. Total depravity, that radical corruption of which R.C. Sproul speaks, that total depravity of which the 5 points speak, it's a wrong order of priorities, that God is not at the pinnacle of our hierarchy, that some aspect of our self, which is actually a diminishment of the self, some aspect of our carnality is at the pinnacle, and that is what misorders us, and that's why all evil deeds have their root in a basic goodness that is corrupted in some essential sense. That work for you?
I'd have to hear it again, probably. You know what I mean?
I know I do that.
Sometimes it's a little too much for my brain to even.
I hear you. If I hadn't have said it so many times, I'd confuse myself.
No, right. You know, sometimes it's just I haven't really thought that much about exactly what it is. You know, so you've got to. A leg up on me on that. I know that it is, and I haven't thought about what it is. You know. Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, I'll send you some links, but privatio boni. Like I said, it's exceptionally orthodox. The Eastern Orthodox, Roman Catholic Church, I believe the Reformed faith and Lutheran all ascribe to privatio boni. It's one of those things that people don't talk about because it's a little more in depth than most are willing to go. But it's kind of hard to explain sin if you don't make it into nothing.
If you don't make it into nothing?
Well, because God created all things.
Oh, that, right. I got you right. And right, that it's not a created thing.
Yeah, we have a lot of problems. A lot of, I've spent the past year getting a lot into church history, and I want to get a lot more into it. And I know a lot of people say that, you know, I just care about what the Bible says. And I used to agree with that. But you know what? I've come to understand anachronism in my own time. I talk about things now that would have been perfectly understood 20 years ago, and they're completely misconstrued by the words that I use. And if that can happen in the space of 2 decades, what can happen in the space of 2 millennia, you know?
Yeah, I'm reading a book. Hang on just for a second. I can never remember the name of the book. Hang on.
Yep. What are you thinking, Johnny?
I'm sorry?
So what you thinking?
I'm not doing much thinking at the moment.
Yeah, avoid headaches that way. Yellowtail Shiraz. This is some good stuff. You ever tried Yellowtail Shiraz?
Me?
Mm-hmm.
No, I'm not much of a wine drinker.
What are you, gay?
I ain't one of them wine bibbers. I ain't one of them there wine bibbers.
Wine bibbers.
better than beer.
It's the story of Christianity. I can't remember what the guy, it's a Spanish guy's name. I can't remember what his name is. But, volume 1. So it's a, I guess there's volume 2. I got it on my little Kindle here.
Mm-hmm.
But this has been a favorite of a lot of people. As soon as I said I got it, my pastor and another guy that's training for the pastorate is, they're like, oh yeah, it's a good book, you know. But it seems to actually have just a slight Roman slant toward it, but you know, slightly favorable. But he's still honest about it. He still seems to bring out the warts and everything, which is pretty good of the things that the Church of Rome did. But right now, I'm just getting past where Constantine and everything. It's pretty fascinating.
Yeah.
But and I had another. Yeah, but church history is really important. All the stuff that was going on there.
Yeah, I've actually begun to understand why Martin Luther was more trying to reform things than break off, because there really was a, I don't know how to liken it to our modern mindset, because we don't have an understanding of the Roman Catholic Church that they did. And for them, the Roman Catholic Church was almost like the Boy Scouts of America, if you were ever a Boy Scout, or if you're ever in the Marines. Being a Roman Catholic would be like being a Marine. You're never not a Marine. You're only a former Marine or whatnot. You know, right. Roman Catholicism wasn't merely a set of beliefs. It was a hierarchy of your social presence. It was everything that was your identity. Mm-hmm. And to depart from that, I mean, we got to remember that Calvinists get their primary tradition from a dyed-in-the-wool Roman Catholic, Augustine. I mean, he was at the birth of the Roman Catholic Church, and he was, ecclesiastically speaking, as about contrary to your average covenantalist today as you can get. But, I mean, if you look at Martin Luther, if you look at Calvin himself, I mean, he would not think that most of us are Christians. I look at all of these dudes and all how convinced they were, how certain they were, and the lengths that they went to fighting for their causes, and how seriously we take them for it. And then I think, what if when we get to heaven, it's like everything that we get credit for are the things that we have no clue about, and those things that we thought were so glorious, Jesus is like, yeah, you're a bit of a dick there. I think that Martin Luther and John Calvin did a lot of great things, but I think that they were every bit as deeply flawed as any other man. But I'm rambling now, so I'm not sure.
But yeah, I just keep this whole thing about if it's agreeable to you guys to be able to talk a little bit more on the next installment, if you want to do that, or if you wanted to make an offshoot. Whatever you want to do with that, I think we're obviously winding down at this point anyway.
Yeah.
So if we wanted to talk about this whole theory of the punishment being disciplinary rather than and remedial rather than punitive, and this purgatory really is what it is. You have to admit that's what it is. It's purgatory, not hell.
Yeah.
Right.
Very much. Yeah.
All right.
Well, I mean, for me, like, I think I like to take the Bible as a whole, and I think that before what I did when I was 19 and I recommitted my life to Christ, I had read through the Bible in the King James Version several times, but I decided it was time for a new one. So of all the translations I picked, it was the New Living. So over a period of about 5 months, I read through the New Living translation. And it's not a bad translation. It's a lot better than the Message, okay? At least it's a translation.
Oh, yeah.
And after that, I read through the NASB, and then when the ESV came out, like, what, 6-7 years ago, I read through that one. Mm-hmm. And what I started noticing probably 3 or 4 years ago when I first started coming into contact with Universalists was the different lens through which they were seeing the Bible. Because I thought... My approach was, I want to see everything from a bird's eye view, and then I want to pick it apart, get to the guts of it. And that worked really well for me for a while. But the problem that I came up to was that after I got that bird's eye view, I accepted that as gospel truth. I continued to work upon that bird's eye view and pick apart the details while never adjusting my bird's eye view in light of the details that I was picking apart. So, and I alluded to that, I think, before the broadcast began, there came a point where I decided that I wanted to doubt everything. I wanted to call everything into question. And when I began to look at the general theme throughout the Old Testament and see how God was continually correcting, like, I wanted so badly to jump in earlier, but I didn't want to disrespect either one of you. But when you were talking about how is it corrective to wipe out the whole world and leave 8 people, well, even if you take out the angel blood theory, the idea is that these people, if you are a universalist, you're really okay with that because they're going to come to repentance eventually anyway. In the meantime, things have gotten so bad that it's unreasonable for the subsequent generations to have to deal with their BS when God can wipe the slate clean, start from the beginning, and have it work out far better. So that still works out to the corrective bent. The only way to see it as non-corrective is if you're a dyed-in-the-wool, eternal conscious torment believer. But if you're okay with them still not being damned forever, then that can be perfectly corrective. And you can see that in Sodom and Gomorrah. I would say you'd see it even more so in Canaan when God gave them 430 years to repent, which strongly implies that he was sending, if not prophets, he was at least speaking to them in some capacity to which that they could be held accountable. And I just, over and over and over again, I just don't see a God who wants to damn people. I see God saying that he doesn't delight in the destruction of the wicked, yet we have a theology that has him ordaining the destruction of the wicked from eternity past. And I know there's ways to get around that, but what if we stopped trying to get around that and entertained the contrary? What if we could hold two equal and opposite ideas in our mind and remain in doubt? So that's what I did. I said, okay, what if universalism is true? And I went about trying to prove it to myself. And I succeeded. And I went back on the other side trying to disprove it, and I couldn't do it. So I really am probably one of the coldest Calvinists you'll meet in that respect. If God said that everyone but 144,000 were damned, I would accept that and worship him for it. But when I began seeing the possibility of the contrary being true, not just the possibility, but in my mind, almost a certainty, there is a bit of, it's almost like when you find that right piece in the puzzle and then everything else makes sense. The whole, and no matter how certain I was in Calvinism, there was still some very problematic passages for me that the Calvinistic interpretation did not hold water. The moment I interjected in universalism into that, purgatorial universalism into that, the whole Arminianism-Calvinism divide simply vanished. And the whole of Scripture clicked into place for me.
So
that's how it did for me too. It like so many things fall into place when you look at it from this lens. Like, you know, I would think about, you know, how it was gonna look when, you know, you had the multitude standing before the great white throne, and you know, each of these people committed different, you know, levels of sin, and their sin was stronger in some, you know, other people more so than some people, and there's different kinds of sins and so on and so forth. And I always wondered to myself, I'm like, then why the formalities, you know, why this big judgment thing, you know, why not just have them wake up in the lake of fire? Why, you know, what's this whole judgment thing about? And universalism, well, I hate even using the term universalism, because in the term of the word, I'm not a universalist. I would say I'm an evangelical Christian whose eschatology is restorationist, you know, who I believe that, you know, God's overarching plan from day one was to save Adam, who he loves very much, and the way that he did that was he created, you know, well, he came down and became Adam, became the second Adam, to right all the wrongs, you know. And when I started looking at things from this point of view, everything fell into place. Now it makes sense why there's a judgment, there's a great white throne judgment. It's because everybody is going to need to be dealt with in a different way. You know, that's like saying that, you know, you have courts in session here in Hernando County where I live. You have one guy who, you know, he ran a red light, and another guy he murdered, and they both get the electric chair. You know what I'm saying? I never understood it, and I can't. You know, I was a hardcore believer in eternal conscious torment. I used to street preach with the bullhorns, the whole nine yards. My local newspaper wrote about me, you know, that I was ruining people's fun time at the local parade, you know, with my Baptist preaching and so on. And, you know, I went into nursing homes, and I touched on hell in these nursing homes. And I'm kind of, you know, I'm not very happy that I did that. You know, I mean, these people are, like, miserable as it is, and here I am, like, and I even had one of the orderlies say, you can't do that, you know, and at the time I was like, well, yes, I can, because, you know, they're facing hell if they don't know Jesus, and they're going to be in there for all of eternity, so it's better if I do this, and blah, 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 and so, you know, that's where I come from, and like how Eric said that everything snapped into place, that's how it happened for me as well. That's all I have to say about that.
rather than you know, getting back into it, like I said, I think we need to probably have another chapter on it and talk about these things. The whole, you know, what is the purpose of this? What's the purpose of the wrath or purgatory and all those sorts of things? And talk directly about and address these very, what I believe are very blatant passages concerning the final destination of the wicked, and that these passages do not give any indication of anything except goodbye to these people. Basically, you know, there doesn't seem to be any hope in these passages.
Is there room for annihilationism in your interpretation?
Possibly, but the only thing is that again, it could be a metaphorical thing about the smoke of their torment rises up forever, that sort of thing. But just touching really quickly on what Johnny said concerning everybody getting the electric chair, there's a passage that says that there are different levels of reward that are meted out to both the righteous and to the wicked. Everybody going to heaven isn't going to get the same thing either, You know, everybody going to heaven's not going to get the same reward, and everybody going to hell isn't going to get the same reward.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not familiar with that particular passage that you're talking about. You know what he's talking about, Eric?
It's yeah. about being beaten with many stripes or less stripes.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, right. Yeah. I believe that's the word of Christ, you know?
Yeah, I actually believe that verse is talking about the Bema seat, and that certain Christians are going to be beaten.
Well, yeah. Okay. I think Shawn has the right idea that we've covered a lot of ground. So, having said that, hopefully it won't cut us off the moment I go stop the broadcast, because normally we have some post-show discussion or whatever. But in case it does, don't think I mean to hang up on you. But, yeah, I will draw the broadcast to a close here. And I thank the both of you very much for taking the time to do this tonight and have this discussion.
Thank you, Shawn.
Hey, thanks, Johnny.
And hopefully, of course, and hopefully we'll be able to do it very, very soon again. And until then, everyone have a great night. We are the Wandering Pilgrims, and hopefully we're not going to hell and going to die forever. Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.